Hello students, welcome to EPG Patasala. I'm Dr. K.R. Ram Mohan, Associate Professor, Head Department of Anthropology, Sikkim University, Gangtok. Today, we are going to talk a module on culture and civilization school from the paper Theories and Methods in Social Cultural Anthropology. So before we start this module, let us see what are the learning outcomes of this module. To understand the concept of culture through different types of societies, to understand the concept of civilization, to know and understand various related topics and subtopics, to know about the contributions made by different scholars to the concept. So before we go on to see, you all know the basic definitions of what is culture and what is civilization. If we go back, we can also say that E.B. Taylor's definition on culture or civilization, he did not make distinctions between culture and civilization according to E.B. Taylor. But in this module, we are going to see and how this the whole concept of civilization has been understood from different vantage points. Robert Redfield is the pioneer scholar in this civilizational school, or trying to see, understand how different cultures have unmasked the whole process of civilization. According to Redfield, the civilization has two dimensions, namely folk and urban. In this context, what is folk and urban? These are the two different levels of societies. When we say an urban society, it means something to us. When we say a folk society, it means something to us. And these two are not the same society. Though society make of people, society is a group of people living together. But what makes a social science student to understand features of a folk society and features of an urban society? So Redfield studied how the folk villages and the urban center, see the two distinctions here. We say folk village and urban center. He made further effort to understand the patterns and processes of interaction between these two societies who are at the different levels of development. So it is a question of development. How one society has remained at a folk level, and why it has remained at a folk level, and why some societies have gone past and have reformed and shaped into an urban center. Hence, Redfield developed the concepts of a folk society and an urban society. Lastly, he also developed a concept called folk-urban continuum. In a sense that how these two societies at different levels of degrees of development are confluenced at one point of level, and what is the continuum, what aspects make the people to be in some sort of continuum in these two societies. In the process of development of a civilization, a crucial aspect holds an important place, that is religion. Religion as a system, as a social system, plays an important place. And to understand the role of religion in the development of civilization is very important, according to Robert Redfield. Folk society has a different set of religious beliefs and practices, and urban centers have different set of religion and religious practices. Knowing the important role played by religion in these two societies, Redfield developed a concept called the concept of great and little traditions as the anchor point of civilizations. And civilization sometimes is a complex whole of both great and little traditions. We can find the great tradition elements in the same society and some extent the attributes or process of little traditions. According to Redfield, the great tradition refers to the formal literate tradition of a civilization. That means the presence of a text, scripture, something is recorded in the form of a tradition. And he says that this text or this literature is completely regulated by the elite of that particular society, what we call the specialists, the ritual specialists, or people who are specialized in disseminating the knowledge of the religious tradition, or the scripture, or something which is written in these texts, which is encoded in the text. It could be of moral values, it could be of forms of power or worship, the concept of righteousness, piousness, all these things are encoded in these literature. So, at one hand, we have this great tradition which has the elite people, which has some scripture, literature is there, and specialized people are there. At the other hand, we have a little tradition which refers to formal illiterate tradition of rural people, which could be absence of a text. So, you have to remember that the two distinctions between great and little tradition, there could be a text and there is an absence of a text. And basically, according to Redfield, this little tradition, perhaps they might be having illiterate group, which cannot go through the literary things and all, or there is an absence of the literary things. Now, Redfield studying these two societies at 2 degrees, at one end you have a great tradition, at one end you have a little tradition. Redfield also introduced the term cultural specialist. A cultural specialist, in a sense that is more trained, he has the knowledge or wisdom of all the supernatural things. Perhaps it could be an ascribed status who mediates between these two traditions. At one end, he is full of knowledge of these things and he is also aware of this little tradition things, the folk things. So, for the first time, Redfield has introduced this concept as cultural specialists, which are completely devoted to this kind of the role that he plays in this society, and he has a high esteem in these two societies. So, joining the bandwagon, many anthropologists in US, such as Oscar Lewis, Mickey Marriott, Milton Singer, and Mandelbaum, has fully supported Redfield's concept of this folk urban continuum, and they conceived with their own ethnographic studies in this whole process of civilization study proposed by the Redfield. Redfield and along his followers also visited India and studied various villages in order to understand what happened even in Indian civilization. Though Redfield's study was in the South American villages, especially in Mexico, Tepoztlán. But he also wants to study how this part of the world and what kinds of civilization process has taken place. So, that made him curious to come over to this civilization studies. Now, what is the concept of a folk society? So, during 1927-28, Redfield visited a traditional village called, just now I said, Tepoztlán, later which he published in 1930. Having done an ethnographic study in this village, Redfield has characterized that folk societies into certain attributes. So, when we say that any folk society, this society is folk society, so what do you mean by this folk society? Basically, it is isolated from the main civilization, what we call the mainstream. Numerically, it is small in size. And there is a tremendous feeling of the togetherness, that we are all one. No matter the density, that we all have this feeling, we feeling, what we call. And they also recognize the other neighboring societies as they. So what happens when you have this feeling of we and they? That means there is a bonding. There are certain common interests. There could be less conflicts. And this communal feeling gives a greater kinship system. And there is an absence of complexity in terms of division of labor. This simple division of labor could be based on gender and based on some specialization. That you do this work, we do this work, and there is an exchange. And the other important factor of this is homogeneity, absence of hierarchy. All have this same quote-unquote egalitarian, that someone is not high, someone is not low. So there is this bonding we can see in these folk societies. And as I said before, that religion plays an important role, either both in folk societies or in urban societies. We can clearly see, according to Redfield, the presence of magic. Magic in a sense that it is not magic done by a magician. Magic in a sense that there is some kind of belief system where sacred prevails over secular, sacred and profane. And people are not bothered just only for the status. Economy is basically is subsistence economy, and it is only for a status. If somebody wants to improve their economy, it's only for a status, but not for a survival. So these are the basic common features when we say what is a folk society. If we go to a small village and we can see if these characters fit into this schema, if not all, most of the fit given by the Redfield's typology, then we can safely say perhaps this society fits or comes under a folk society. Basing on the lines of this folk society, basically this is a peasant society who are basically on agriculture. And Redfield developed further this concept of what is a peasant society. So he has done ethnographic fieldwork on a small society called Chankom Society. And he postulated that a peasant society has a great love for their own land. And there is a complete attachment with the people and the land. So there is a symbiotic relationship between land and people, because land is the source of their subsistence economy. And they consider this as their mother, not the kinship mother. Again, further developing the concept of peasant society, Redfield says that peasant societies are relatively self-contained, possesses their own indigenous culture, which is unique in their own context. It has a structure where all the parts of it are arranged in a logical way, and they are guided by value system. How people place value for gender, for economy, for gods, or for land. So this reflects the whole gamut of the value system. So according to Redfield, the peasant society is different from the folk society only because it has developed a market system. So the subtle difference between a folk society and a peasant society is that peasant society, you have a surplus production. So what do you do with the surplus production? The production is sold. And this is a major difference between a folk and a peasant society. And they are in a constant touch with the urban areas or urban centers, because you have to sell your goods. And there is a give and take relationship. Perhaps this could be a major feature that the evolution of this market system, and they have at the periphery the close connections between the urban center traders and the peasants who sold their products. Apart from this character, the rest of the features like that these people are also isolated, there is a togetherness, there is a we feeling, and there is extreme strength of personal relations. People are guided by common interests. The strong kinship systems are there, along with homogeneity and the presence of magic, which are also equally found in the folk society. Taking further the concept of peasant society, Redfield observed that peasant society is unique in its own and has its main attributes, namely, all peasants have a high reverent attitude towards the land. Why? Because land is the source of their livelihood. Land is the source for their entire generations to survive. So, along with the highest form of worship, the immediate reality is their land, which they survive for many generations. Perhaps this idea is also being seen in other societies like fishing communities or another tribal societies, where when you have an attachment towards your own survival things, you have a highest reverent attitude. And peasant society also hold an idea or a belief system which is put in practice that agriculture is good and trade or business is bad, in a sense that the profit motive is absence. And they fully internalized in their personality the industrious nature, which means working hard is the highest virtue in their life or a value of life. If you ask them, what do you cherish or what is the highest value in the society? The immediate answer in this peasant society, most of them, they say that we have to work hard, not to make profit, but to survive, to continue the generations for many years. Now, having said the features of a folk society, having said the features of the peasant society, Redfield wants to take how these two forms of societies or at a civilizational process had some kind of a continuum, some kind of a connection between these two. At what point these two are related? And he says that it is fork urban continuum. So, taking this further, Redfield worked upon four communities, namely city society, which is very large, a town society, which is lesser than a city, but it has most of the features of a society. Then we have peasant society and the folk and simple society. So, he has taken on a plane that at one point you have this city, you have town, you have peasant, and you have the folk. And at the same line, you have a different sets of characteristic features of the society. So, all these four different sets of society has taken from in the Mexican province of Yucatan. And these communities are located with the different habitations or Marida, which is a city society, Dijas, which is a town or a rural society, and Chankom, a peasant society or a peasant village, and Tuski is a village of folk society. So he has seen, taken all the four, and he has seen what aspects they are being connected, and in this line he has proposed this concept of folk urban continuum. Now, as I said, these are at the same plane, and we can see and how these two are related. If you draw a line and we see all these things. Now, at one end you have this urban center, and at one end you have this folk center. So these two are completely at opposite directions, like east and west. Now, when we say that this urban center and when we say that this is a folk center, what makes these two? Because of their characteristic features. Whereas the folk and the peasant society has some common features, because these are the end of this continuum process. These two are closely related. And at these two, the city center and the town had some kind of a features, where the certain traits are similar to the urban center and certain traits are similar to the town centers. There is a market system here. There is some kind of relations between the traders, the middleman, and the business that is taking place from towns to urban centers. So in this way, he says that there is some kind of continuum taking place which are nearby to each other because of the relations that they have. Now, coming to another concept, Redfield again says that the concept of a little community. So what is a little community according to Redfield? It is a small group of people living together with all the characteristic features of a community. Now, he says that this little community perhaps could be a reflection of the whole human life or human world. Now, this little community is very distinctive, very unique in its density, in its size, which is small. As I said, these are all homogeneous without any distinction, and basically they are self-sufficient. Now, what is the use of studying the little community? Because little communities are the basic units and representative of the larger whole. See, in the whole study of civilization, we cannot isolate a small society and say that, yes, this is a very small society and we need to discard this society. But this society is a replica of nothing but the whole society, which gives many understandings to study other parts of the bigger world. As Redfield time and again says that religion plays an important role in understanding these civilization process. As he proposed, the small societies or the folk societies have the little tradition, and the urban societies have the great tradition, which has a literate and which is not literate. And he says that the great tradition was very formal and the little tradition was informal, which is how does this great tradition spreads? Where is the dissemination knowledge? What is the dissemination center? Where does this knowledge has been passed through other places? Redfield says that great tradition takes place in the schools and temples. But whereas, because these are the institutionalized centers, people are taught how to read, how to understand, how to recite, and the meaning of all these traditional things are being explained in an institutional form, in a systematic way. But on the contrary, the little tradition is completely passed through oral tradition because there is an absence of the text. So when there is absence of the text, how people pass the knowledge to the further generations? It is through oral tradition. Now, within the oral tradition and within the text tradition, both the cultural specialist play a key role. So these are the people who are specialized in passing down these religious knowledge, and these people are called cultural specialists. Having said Redfield's contributions, there is another important anthropologist who has taken further and conceptualized the whole concept of Redfield's definition of, is Oscar Lewis. Oscar Lewis is famous in India because his excellent ethnographic study of Rampur village in Uttar Pradesh. And he has the first-hand experience of seeing what is happening really in an Indian village. And he found out, he discovered that Indian village, especially in Rampur, they have this deep-seated community feeling or a sentiment. Every villager has this sense of belongingness, that I belong to this village. He is from my village. She is from my village. So what is this concept of my village? That we are living together in the same place for many years. And he is like me. And I am like him. This kind of a feeling which is very strong in this village, which is Oscar Lewis has found out. Here, Lewis says that the relationship is not only between the two individuals, but the individual with the nature, the immediate surrounding nature, with his land, with his house, with his domestic animals, with the herbs and shrubs, with the plants, and the other natural objects surrounding in the village or in his house. And this becomes a form of an Indian village. This becomes a basis for a village. Now, Lewis also further described that the relation such as man to his land at one aspect and individual to individual another relation, which is further guided by a religious order, that people have a faith in the highest form of supernatural thing, and they are being socially guided, they have some kind of regulation of behavior to control social control is through political organization, some kind of a business relations which further extended this village. Now, if the village has some kind of a connection with the immediate other neighboring town, he used this word as rural cosmopolitan. We should also know another significant anthropologist who studied in India is Mickey Marriott. Mickey Marriott is also very famous for his studies in India and he floated concepts. In his one of his study, Little Communities in an Indigenous Civilization, because he called Indian civilization as indigenous civilization. And he proposed with his study the concept of universalization and parochialization. So his ethnographic fieldwork is in an Indian village called Kishangari in Uttar Pradesh. So basing on his ethnographic fieldwork in this village, he propounded this concept of universalization. So what is this universalization? Universalization is a process by which the cultural traits of a little tradition are absorbed into the great tradition. Hence, the local process or the phenomena becomes universalized. On the other hand, at one end it is universalization, the other end is parochialization, is just the reverse of the universalization phenomena. In this, the written, the literate things such as Vedas, Shastras, are learned and then modified by the folk or the peasant society. And this culminates into their ritualistic practices. Another anthropologist who has significantly contributed to civilization studies in India is Milton Singer. Now, Singer's works is mostly important in the city of Madras. Now it is Chennai. Now, he wants to understand what is happening at an urban center and how, what kinds of religion plays in an urban center. So, he worked a lot in the contemporary study of religious traditions in India, and he wants to culminate, see how these great and little traditions are being in flux together, especially in the city of Madras then. So, Milton Singer done a textual and contextual analysis of written and oral traditions. He has taken the main text and it is seen how people have these oral traditions and how the role of culture plays in this whole process of internalization of both little and great tradition, and how the great tradition has modernized itself in the sphere of a little tradition. With this analysis of taking these two traditions together, Milton Singer has developed the concept of cultural geography, which is an important aspect both in geography and in an anthropology. So how in a geographical situation, in a geographical place, given a place, what are the important cultural performances which is unique to that place? When we say geography in general, we talk of the climate, the topography, the heights, the way, the distances. But when we use the word cultural geography, which is unique, how a culture is displayed, how a culture is performed, how a culture is exhibited in that particular geography or geographical area, is called cultural geography. Not only the performances, the cultural specialists, the cultural media such as songs, bhajans, kirtans, prarthana, and lot of songs, what we call geets, which are being combined together, and see how and why these are only in this place. And Singer was of opinion that all these aspects interact and form the basis of interaction between both the little tradition and the great tradition. How a particular text has been modified and put into a song which is easily available for the people to sing and chant. There is no need of reading the whole text in that particular area, because it has taken from a great tradition which has incorporated into the little tradition of to that particular society and which has been manifested in the form of a bhajan or a song which has its roots in the great tradition which is in the text. And it becomes a complex whole where the source of interaction is the mixing of these two traditions. Along with these other anthropologists, we should also know something about Morris E. Oppler. He has also done many works in India, and his famous ethnographic works is in Sainapur, again in Uttar Pradesh. So he has taken an academic help from Dr. R.D. Singh, which is a unique concept called concept of unity and extension of Indian villages. So along with R.D. Singh, Morris Oppler explained how in a village a unity and extension prevails. For example, whenever they see any kind of a celebration within the village, it could be a religious celebration, it could be a family celebration, or any sort of celebration where people come together, or a community ritual, It could be a happy occasion of a marriage or a sorrow occasion like death, or in another form which a violence erupts, rivalry. There is a sense of feeling where the whole village comes together and that depicts that there is a strong bond. In all these occasions, marriage, death, ritual, rivalry, any kind of things which is happening, and they also found out that exogamy is practiced in their marriage, that people should marry outside their own groups. Now, when people are marrying outside the group, there is some kind of expansion of their kin relations. So your relationships are extended, which has an implicit meaning for trade purpose. So that when in anthropology we see how the marital distance, we ask people and says that where does your wife come or where do your husband come from? Then we try to see the distance. This village to that village, 30 kilometers or 100 kilometers. So in that sense, we calculate the marital distance. And what kind of relations you have with other villages. If they have their own thing, then we can say that the marital relations are only within this. Or they have marital relations with outside the villages. So in that sense, we can calculate this marital relations. So in this Senapur, they also found that people are marrying outside their villages and they're extending their kinship relations. And because of their extended kinship relations, they have the business relations, they are getting education, medical facilities, and they're going for a pilgrimage, and they're connected to the urban markets. So this study shows that though villages are being deeply rooted within their own culture, within their own community, but also they have these extended relations. So in that sense, Oppler has concepted that a village as a basic unit, which is a strong unit, but they have these extended relations with other villages for a variety of reasons, for various purposes, for education, for economy, for market system, all these things which shows that they're being extended. Now, to summarize this whole module on culture and civilization studies, we have to understand key concepts that in a civilization, different societies are at different ends. So the famous Redfield's typology, which he says that there is an urban center, at the another continuum there are the towns, and the another continuum we have this prison society, and in the last continuum we have the folk society. Another interesting features as Redfield proposed is how religion plays in this whole civilization process and what makes this distinction. He says that in the towns you have, in the urban center you have this great tradition. In the folk or in the simple societies, you have the little tradition. Joining these concepts, we have many other anthropologists which have significantly contributed. Mickim Marriott, which has given this concept of universalization and parochialization. Milton Singers, his ethnographic works on how religion is incorporated into an urban center, taking both these traditions together. And we have Oppler's work on Senapur, who says that how a village is structured at unity and how, without losing this unity, how they could establish more contacts with the outside their territories. So this gives a broad idea that civilization is at a continuum and societies are linked together at various levels and phases for their own reasons, which gives many clues to understand that societies developed and they are placed at different levels of civilization process.